Hello and welcome. My name is Robin and you're watching Robin Reads. Today I'm going to do another book haul with you guys, a NetGalley book haul. I do this every month, and this month I'm going to be talking about the ARCs I got for the month of September. And I tried to do this as diversely as I could, so I have 9 ARCs and I'm going to try and read them before their release date. And yeah, just let's get started. I will be looking at my laptop down here, so hope you don't mind. So the first book that I got is called Some Are Always Hungry. It's by Yi Hyun. And it's a poetry collection. It's out on the 1st of September. And I will read the blurb. Winner of the Prairie Schooner Book Prize in Poetry, Some Are Always Hungry chronicles a family's wartime survival, immigration and heirloom trauma through the lens of food or the lack thereof. Through the vehicle of recipe, butchery and dinner table poems, the collection negotiates the myriad ways diasporic communities comfort and name themselves in other nations, as well as the ways cuisine is inextricably linked to occupation, transmission and survival. Dwelling on the personal as much as the historical, Some Are Always Hungry traces the lineage of the speaker's place in history and diaspora through myth-making and cooking, which is to say conjuring. So I mentioned in a last video, I think, that I am going to be reading a lot of poetry, and this is one of them, and it sounds very interesting. So yeah, let's get onto the other poetry collection that I got. It's called Scenery, and it's by José Felipe Alvergu, I think. Sorry if I'm butchering these names. It's out on the 1st of September, and the blurb is this. In Scenery, lyrics, public voice and memoirs, personal reconciliations confront the archives of America's racial and legal histories, resulting in a genre-bending exploration of what it means to exist as oneself for an other. The author, a Salvadorian immigrant and parent, reflects on the status of personhood in America between racial supremacy and racial disavowal, thinking through his own structural role as a naturalized citizen and naturalization's historical condition in the denial of full legal and emotional black personhood. This daring work delves into the archive of liberal humanism, from colonial-era writing on the competing status of slaves to the present, while the visual archive of public news provides an ekphrastic environment to the author's bigger lyric memory, being the parent of a biracial American-born child in a contemporary era accentuated by violence, white nationalism, and fear. From 17th century Casta paintings up to contemporary coverage of domestic unrest and riots, from the delivery room to scenes of parenthood, Alvergu ponders what is the kind of emotion a face demonstrates, or a body, an assembly, scenery approaches in asymptotic manner, the empathy we come to feel when the language we've made is dulled by the roles we are also expected to occupy against one another. Sound very good. Little bit of a hard read, like the difficult language, but I hope it will be fine. Then I got a book also out on the 1st of September. It's called The Secret Lives of Church Ladies by Disha Filio, I think. And this is a literary fiction, multicultural interest kind of book. And this is the blurb. Short stories about race and sexuality by a Pittsburgh author whose work on African American topics has appeared in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and McSweeney's. The Secret Lives of Church Ladies explores the raw and tender places where black women and girls dare to follow their desires and pursue a momentary reprieve from being good. The 9 stories in this collection feature 4 generations of characters grappling with who they want to be in the world, caught as they are between the church's double standards and their own needs and passions. There is 14-year-old Joel, who has a crush on the preacher's wife. At 42, Lara realizes that her discomfort with her own body stands between her and the new love as Y2K looms. Carolatta's same time next year arrangement with her childhood best friend is tenuous. A serial mistress lays down the ground rules for her married lovers. In the dark shadows of a hospice parking lot, grieving strangers find comfort in each other. With their secret longings, new love, and forbidden affairs, these church ladies are as seductive as they want to be, as vulnerable as they need to be, as unfaithful and unrepentant as they care to be, and as free as they deserve to be. So this one really sounds very, very good, and yeah, just, I don't really read a lot of short stories, so I hope I will like them. Then I got a YA fiction novel, I think. It's called Like Spilled Water, and it's by Jenny Liu. It's out on the 1st of September, and this is the blurb. 19-year-old Na has always lived in the shadow of her younger brother Bao Bao, her parents' cherished son. Years ago, Na's parents left her in the countryside and went to work in the city, bringing Bao Bao along and committing everything to his education. But when Bao Bao dies suddenly, Na realizes how little she knew him. But did he really kill himself because of a low score on China's all-important college entrance exam? Na learns that Bao Bao had many secrets and that his death may not be what it seems. Na's parents expected her to quit her vocational school and go to work, forcing Na to confront traditional expectations for and pressures on young women. Again, sounds very good. All of these sound amazing. Don't really know what I can say more, so I will just go on. Another poetry collection, it's called 18 Inches, The Distance Between the Heart and Mind by Mirtha Michelle Castro Marmol. And it's out on the 15th of September. This is the blurb. These poems explore the distance between the head and the heart, and all of the pain, beauty, and hope in between. This book is one woman's account of her longing to know herself fully, her mind, body, and soul. This book might make you cry, fill you with nostalgia, empower you, or even give you hope. You might not see eye to eye with every idea inside, but with any luck you'll see your soul reflected in its pages. You will question things. You will remember your past. You will be thankful for your present. You will dream a new dream. Above all, you will feel welcome. Above all, you will feel welcome to the journey of 18 inches, a battlefield between a woman's beat up heart and her complex mind. Again, very good. Sorry if I need to correct what I'm saying because the dots are a bit vague on these pages. So the sentences aren't always very clear. Next one is called Long Live the Post Horn. And it's by Vigdis Jorth. And it's a general fiction adult novel. It's out on the 15th of September. And this is the description. Eleanor, a 35-year-old media consultant, has not been feeling herself. She's not been feeling much at all lately. Far beyond jaded, she picks through an old diary and fails to recognize the woman in its pages, seemingly as far away from the world around her as she's ever been. But when her co-worker vanishes overnight, an unusual new task is dropped on her desk. Off she goes to meet the Norwegian Postal Workers Union, setting the ball rolling on a strange and transformative 6 months. This is an existential scream of a novel about loneliness and the postal service, written in Vigdis Hjorth's trademark spare rhythmic and cutting style. Very good. Then I have one that is called Football's Fearless Activists. How Colin Kaepernick, Eric Reid, Kenny Stills and fellow athletes stood up to the NFL and President Trump. By Mike Freeman. Out on the 15th of September. I saw this book and I was immediately, yes, I want to read that. I, of course, knew that this happened, but not really in depth because I don't really follow the news that much. So I think this book will be very interesting. And yeah, it's just including interviews and yeah, I'm not going to read the whole description. I think it speaks for itself what it's about. Then I have Generation Brave, the Gen Z kids who are changing the world by Kate Alexander. It's a children's nonfiction and it's out on the 22nd of September. Description. An illustrated celebration of a Gen Z activist fighting to make our world a better place. Gen Z is populated and defined by activists. They are bold and original thinkers and not afraid to stand up to authority and conventional wisdom. From the march of our lives to the fight for human rights and climate change awareness, this generation is leading the way toward truth and hope like no generation before. Generation Brave showcases Gen Z activists who are fighting for change on many fronts: climate change, LGBTQ rights, awareness and treatment of mental illness, gun control, gender equality and corruption in business and government at the highest level. Illustrated throughout, this book will offer a celebration of what might be the most influential generation of the century. Yeah, this sounds super good because I really think this will be very important for children and also for myself because I probably won't know a lot of these people. I think they're all like very young. So then the last book that I have is called West of Jim Crow, The Fight Against California's Color Line. It's by Lynn M. Hudson. And it's History Multicultural Interest. It's out on the 28th of September. The description. African American resistance to white supremacy from California's statehood to the 1950s. African Americans who moved to California in hopes of finding freedom and full citizenship instead faced all too familiar racial segregation. As one transplant put it, the only difference between Pasadena and Mississippi is the way they are spelt. From the beaches to streetcars to schools, the Golden State, in contrast to its reputation for tolerance, perfected many methods of controlling people of color. Lynn M. Hudson deepens our understanding of the practices that African Americans in the West deployed to dismantle Jim Crow in the quest for civil rights prior to the 1960s. Faced with institutionalized racism, black Californians used both established and improvised tactics to resist and survive the state's color line. Hudson rediscovers forgotten stories like the experimental all-black community of Ellensworth, the California Ku Klux Klan campaign of terror against African Americans, the bitter struggle to integrate public swimming pools in Pasadena and elsewhere, and segregationists' preoccupation with gender and sexuality. Lynn M. Hudson is an associate professor of history at the University of Illinois at Chicago, and she's the author of The Making of Mammy Pleasant, a black entrepreneur in 19th century San Francisco. So this is nonfiction history, and I have actually never read a history novel book before, so I'm very excited about this. Also, just the topic I think is very important to know things about. So yeah, I think I have a good selection. These are all still available on NetGalley, so please go to the links below and request these if you are interested. And yeah, I really hoped you liked this video, and please give it a thumbs up, comment and subscribe, and I will see you later. Later.